fuck the law. I want meat. Look alive, you suffer. I was like, I knew there was a quote from Nightbreed that I was going to use to intro this when I watched it last night. I just fucking couldn't remember what it was until I just saw it.
Perfect.
Episode 259 of IP Suffer. My name is Nathan.
And I'm Katie.
Kit, also out getting jaws.
Yeah.
Shark teeth implanted into his head. But not where you would expect.
Ooh. It's his nose.
Yeah. He's just tiny shark teeth. Fucking terrible.
Shark nose.
Yeah. So this week, Katie and I are going to talk about some queer horror movies that were a real bummer, despite all being good.
Well,
Caitlin and I talked about it when we did like the Death Drop Gorgeous episode, where I was like, we were trying to find something to cover, but that wasn't like depressing, and I was like, that's very difficult.
It's hard, yeah.
Because it seems to be like what... I mean, there's a lot of... I'm guessing probably newer movies that like would probably fit that category, but I also kind of wanted to talk about some like classics that were like good and would, you know, stuff that we probably wouldn't cover normally.
Yeah, I think just like speaking to that, I think it is hard because like a lot of times if you're seeking out like queer media, maybe not recently, like you said, there's a lot of new stuff that obviously neither of us have seen. But for a while, it was like one of those things where everything that was like, let's take Cruising, for example. It's, you know, literally about a cop who has to like, quote unquote, infiltrate this like leather scene. But it's because like gay men are being killed and there's a serial killer and they need to stop it. And they focus it really, I feel like, on the fact that, like, they're gay, so that's why this is happening to them kind of situation. Or, like, all of the plot is driven by the fact, by whatever orientation a person happens to be. And that's not, like...
good or great.
Yeah, right. So it's, like, obviously, Cruising is from the 80s, and I was actually really surprised that there was cops doing anything at all in this movie to try and, like, save these men. But, like, obviously, it's still not a great climate, and things are changing, but I never thought about it until... Did you watch Schitt's Creek?
No, I've seen, like, random episodes, because Caitlin watched it, like, sometime during... I don't know, right, like, I think right after it, like, officially ended, they just, like, binged the whole thing. It's, okay. I would catch episodes, but not enough.
Essentially, the show is about this, like, family who's, like, really well off. This is just for people who don't know what it is. And they go bankrupt, and they have to live in this, like, small town and, like, rough it in a motel or whatever. And, I guess mild spoiler, if for some reason you haven't seen that and you want to, you can skip it. But this is bringing it around to my point. The main character is it Daniel? Dan Levy?
I know Dan Levy's in it. I don't know if he's the main character.
He is.
I mean, I know he's one of the family. He's the...
Eugene is his dad. Yeah. I get their names mixed up. My bad. I feel like Eugene Levy is, like, very well known. Dan more so now, obviously, since that show. The show's really great. It's really, really funny. One of the points in it is that he meets this other person in town and starts having a relationship with them, and then... but his partner's not out, and so there's like a storyline where he has to come out to his family, and it all goes fine. And then apparently there was like backlash because they were like, well, there's no tension around this, really. Like, it all ended up fine. It's fine. And there was, like, this, like, thing that they did with all of the actors after the show, just kind of, like, interviewing them and talking about it. And he essentially, you know, they were like, well, why didn't you have any more kind of, like, strife around, like, the fact that this character has to come out as gay to his parents or whatever? And he was just like, why? Like, and it just, yeah, like, really...
Like, there's especially, like, kind of, like, in the horror genre, which is, like, I get it. Like, it is, it's all usually through a traumatic lens. And, like, so we're gonna be talking about three movies, and Cruising is one of them. And Cruising is the one that's, like, blatantly very straight-made.
Yeah.
And,
oh, yeah.
Like, it's a movie I've been wanting to see for a long time, and, like, just never got around to it. And, like, I thought it would be interesting to talk about in this episode, just solely based on, like, sort of the controversies around it, and sort of, like, because I, like, it's one of those things where I know I 100% get, like, why queer people were mad about this in the first place.
Yeah.
But I also, like, I know a lot of, like, queer horror fans that adore this movie. And it's, like, it's a very weird sort of, like, one of those, like, dichotomies where I feel like it just maybe kind of swung around a little bit. And, like, it is, like, a very specific snapshot of a very specific time in America. Because this came out, like, I think, I forget what the exact time was. IMDb's trivia is not working at the moment. Like within a year of the first, like, AIDS case hitting, like, New York City, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
And so it came out, like, right, like, literally right before, like, shit got, like, really bad for gay men in New York City. Not that it was probably great before that, but, like, you know, like, when it got, like, the, like the real shitty, like bigotry against them happening. And it's just, I don't know, it's a very interesting sort of, like, snapshot of a time period that, like, not a lot of people were, like, you know, like, I was not born yet. Like, obviously a lot of people were born, but, like, just a, like, a lot of people our age, like, were not just around for.
Yeah, it's the 70s, so, like, yeah, most, yeah, pretty much.
And it's, yeah. Like, I thought it was, like, I thought it would be an interesting look, because the three movies we're going to cover is Cruising from 1980, Nightbreed from 89, I think, and then... 90? Is it 90?
Yeah, 89 or 90.
And then Knife Plus Heart from 2018, I believe. And I thought it would be, like, an interesting look to see, like, how, like, different a queer slasher, and, like, you know, we'll talk about it in Cruising. Cruising's got very heavy giallo vibes to it. And, like, just that, like, how different, like, these two... like, deadly serious, like, queer horror movies are from, like, that time, like, just this, like, from then to now. So, yeah, that'll probably be in our discussions.
Yeah, so, anyways, what I was saying is, so, yeah, so people were mad about, like, about what happened in Schitt's Creek, and he was essentially just like, well...
that's what we spun off of.
Yeah, he was essentially just like, why? Like, things that happen in our lives, like, we deserve to have something that's just, like, a story about two people finding each other and falling in love and their story without it having to be a big thing or making it about, like, whatever your orientation may be. And so it's like, that's, like, such a straight thing to be like, oh, well, if you're two men and you want to get married, then obviously there's going to be issues around
it's,
that.
It's, there's like a whole, like, thing, like, that's still what, like, major studios think, like, black people want to see. And
right.
This is like 12 Years a Slave and just right. That. And it's like, no, like, can we have, like, some joy?
Also, it's like, why do you want to take that one defining terrible thing that could happen to somebody? Like, I don't know. Obviously, it just goes to show their ignorance, because it's like everything and every like experience that makes up a person isn't whether they're like gay or straight or bi or like whatever. Like, that's not really and it's sad. Anyways, but what I was trying to say is that really like that was like something that I just had never thought of before. And when he said that, I was like, oh my God, you're totally right. Like, why does this have to be a big thing? Like, it shouldn't, first of all, at all. And so, like, you don't really need to just keep making media that, like, you know, perpetuates that. And so what I was trying to say is, like, bringing it back around, a lot of these movies are really, really heavy to watch, because it's not just, like, a horror movie about, like, I don't know, somebody that's a serial killer, which is, like, bad enough, right? Like, don't kill people. But it's, like, an added kind of, like, just like terrible aspect of what's going on. And so I feel like for me, that's why like I don't think that I've seen a lot of queer movies, because my impression of what I've seen is a lot like Cruising.
Sure.
Where the main crux is like it is based on that. And what I like is, I guess I read a lot more. Like, my favorite, like, genre is, like, sapphic horror, and a lot of times it's not focused on the relationship at all, which I love. It's just, like, two people, and then something terrible is happening. Mm-hmm. Like, I have to have the horror element of it right, but I don't necessarily want that to be the bad thing that's happening in the movie, in, like, the story, so...
Yeah, like, I think, it's definitely changed in some aspect in the couple years, although like Blumhouse kind of
Boo.
Also did a fucking terrible job with they/them, so also not great. But like, I also like, I think there has been a bit of a swing of like if you look at Death Drop Gorgeous, for example, like it is like people are getting killed, it's a slasher, which is like traumatic,
right?
But it's like, it wasn't made to be, like, it's blatantly, like, campy, there's jokes in it, it's fun, like, it's over the top, and it's, like, fun to watch. Like, I don't watch that movie and just get, like, depressed about the world,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And, like, I don't think, there seems to be more of that now, but, like, specifically when I was, like, picking the movies for this episode, like, before we, like, I settled on Nightbreed, the other movie was going to be Titan, which is, like, a masterpiece, but bleak. And, like,
yeah.
I think you had watched Cruising and, like, Knife Plus Heart back to back, and I said something about Titan, and you were just like,
no.
Yeah, I don't know. and I was like, yeah, well, we'll do Nightbreed then. Nightbreed's, like, at least fun, and it's, like, it's not specifically like queer horror, but it's very like, I don't know, like it's like, well, we'll get into it when we talk about it, but like
sure,
yeah, like there's like, when I was looking at movies, there's like movies from the last couple years that I'm like, I don't know, like maybe we could pick this, like there's a movie like So Vam about like the I haven't seen it, I've only seen people talk about it. I think it's just about like gay vampires.
Yeah, I saw that on the I saw the poster and I was like looking at it, but
and I was just like, I don't know, like it's just like, I don't feel like that's something we would watch and have like a lot to say about, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so I was like, I don't know, like, and especially like most new movies, especially new horror movies, just like don't work for me, and I didn't want like this episode to just be us like shitting on something.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
So I was like, I don't know, like it would probably be interesting to do like these three movies specifically, and yeah, I don't know. I got opinions. All of them I think are very good.
Okay.
Like I, well, we'll fucking dive in. Well, actually, before we dive into it, so we have a new Patreon. Shout out. For another mark, we're collecting marks.
Oh yeah, get in here, Mark.
I actually know this mark. I don't think I know who the previous one was, but He's a good dude. Has a like synth project called Fancy Mark that is really
I
good.
love that.
If you're into that shit. Anyway, thanks, Mark. Thanks for the support.
Thanks, Mark.
Hope you enjoy those bonus episodes. And Katie and I talk about Spider-Man 200 times.
Literally.
All right, yeah, we'll like dive into 1980s Cruising by William Friedkin, starring Al Pacino, who he hated.
Ooh.
He spent like almost like immediately after the film was done. He's like, I don't know, this would have been better if I could have got Richard Gere. At least he could act. I like Pacino in it, but.
I don't have a problem with Pacino. I have to say, like, I had never heard of this movie somehow, even though obviously I'm very familiar with Friedkin. Not super, like, obviously everyone knows who Al Pacino is, but I don't think I really know him outside of, like, Scarface, to be fair. So I wasn't really sure what to
You didn't see him in
expect.
Adam Sandler's Jack and Jill?
I did, obviously, left a huge impression on me. So I wasn't sure really what to expect, but I think he plays the part. Like, I think he did a good job.
He was a fucking great actor in like the 70s and 80s and like even into the 90s before he became the like sort of joke stereotype of Al Pacino. Like he's fucking incredible in Heat, and that's like right at that border where it's like he's like teetering over the edge of becoming the like version he's known for now. But like his 80s and 70s output is he's good. There's a reason he's like he's Al Pacino. Yeah, I don't know. I really like this. I think I gave it 4.5 stars. Like it, I
You
think.
did.
I think Friedkin is like obviously an incredible director, and like problematic shit aside in the movie, like it looks incredible. The cinematography is incredible. Like the lighting is incredible. The score rocks. Like I like everyone acting in it. It's I don't know. I think like. If you're able to sort of get past sort of the like, late 70s sort of view on gay men, like it's a pretty great movie all around.
Yeah, and I have to say that, like, I feel like this is tough, because this movie is about a police officer. So, like, anytime that you have a movie that's like, about cops doing cop stuff, it's always for me going to go either way, right? Either I'm going to be like, absolutely hate this, cops are trash, and but sometimes they
Most
do
of them,
for
they are in this.
right. And I have to say that, like, one of the things that I liked about the movie in that aspect is that they don't hold back. Like, I don't know William Friedkin's view on cops, to be honest with you, but they don't hold back on portraying them as, well, in the very beginning, I was like, movie about cops that are just being bad at their job, which, fair. And then I said, frankly, I'm surprised that they're investigating this at all. So it's a serial killer, like we said, killing men in like the bar scenes, and they specifically say, quote unquote, S&M in leather districts.
Yeah,
I don't
it's
know
like in
how
the meatpacking
accurately,
district.
right,
This is
any of
so.
this,
Oh, go ahead.
I was gonna say, I don't know how accurate any of this is being portrayed, obviously, but there's the lead detective on the case seems to actually, like, at first I was like, he seems to maybe care, but then there's a scene later where maybe his superior or something. Sorry, it's been like 2 weeks since I've watched this
I
because
watched it
we
last
had to
night, so
push
you're
it
good.
back. So, somebody is, but basically they're like, listen, we're going up for re-election, and if you don't find the serial killer, like, I'm not going to be re-elected and you're going to lose your job. So then it's like, oh, okay, so he's only really doing this to try and like save face for the department. And then there's a scene later where they arrest this man that Pacino has falsely led them to thinking is a serial killer, and they just like beat the shit out of him for no reason. And I was like, okay, I feel like this is actually like a pretty honest portrayal of like how they would have been treating these people. So I was like into it. So I guess I didn't say overall, yes, I very much liked the movie.
Yeah. So like one of the things Friedkin does, and especially with this movie, is like a lot of research. And like he actually shot in real like leather S&M bars.
Okay.
And like the like a lot of the so I this is from IMDb. I've listened to a couple podcasts where they talked about this movie, and like I feel like I've heard differing aspects on this, but he apparently like just shot, and like a lot of those scenes are like real club patrons where he basically told them like, do what you do here, but just, you know, try not to like pull your dick out or whatever. So like, cause like I, you know, I still have
fair.
To
admit, yeah.
Cause, well, because there's like 40 minutes cut out of this movie.
Damn.
That is my understanding, like explicitly just like shit in these bars happening that he shot to kind of trick the MPAA to be like, well, you have to cut this stuff out, and then like, you know, be able to ignore the actual like murders and shit like that in it.
Mm-hmm.
And like I think for a long time he denied it, and eventually sometime recently he's like been like, oh no, like that was real. And I guess there's just like an extra 40 minutes of just Al Pacino like watching gay dudes fuck in these bars, and I was
ew,
like, that rocks, give me that.
Well,
give me that cut, fuck the Snyder cut, give me the that cut. And so like, you know, I've also seen reports where people were just like, this isn't, like, a real, like, this is, like, it's a very, like, obviously, like, not all gay bars are full of dudes in leather, like, fisting each other and shit, like, in this movie.
Right.
Which is problematic that, like, it's also, like, it's problematic now, it was then, but it's also one of those things where it's just, like, I don't think a lot of people that weren't going to those clubs really, like, this is probably what they all thought it was like. Like, it was
definitely,
the common thing. And, like, I don't know. It's just, it's interesting. Like, I look at, like I said, like, this movie just feels like a very specific, like, timepiece for that period. And I find it, like, fascinating. It's something, I want to watch this movie again just to kind of, like, now that I know what's happening, and it kind of just sink a lot of that, like, that working with, like, the, like, giallo-esque lighting throughout it.
Yeah.
Like, because especially a lot, like, almost all of the, like, bar scenes are, like, lit blue.
Mm-hmm.
And it just looks great. And then, like, the way he uses, like, there's the scene sort of towards, like, the second half when he's, like, stalking the guy that he thinks is doing. Or I think it's he's, like, stalking the guy that actually is the killer or whatever. I think, I can't remember. But, like, where he's just, like, in these, like, shadows and, like, bushes and on, like, whatever thing he's, like, watching him from, like, up in, like, across from the dude's apartment. And it's, like, I don't know. I fucking loved the way this movie looked.
There was, like, overall, yeah, I really liked it also. There was one scene in particular that I was, like, what is going on here? Where it was, yeah, it was where he was stalking the guy who ends up being the actual killer. And he's, like, a student, and they, like, show the guy. I will also say, the victims of the killer in this, one of the things is, like, the guy has an MO where everybody has, like, a similar look, and the look is Al Pacino. And so a lot of
Al
these men...
Al Pacino with slightly longer hair.
Yeah, a lot of these men look exactly the same, so it is kind of hard to, like, follow some of them. But it is this guy, because he's, like, he's a student, and there's a scene where it's like a long shot of him, like, leaving his apartment, going for a run, going to class, and then it shows, like, it, like, zooms out, and it shows Al Pacino sitting on a like a railing, and then it just goes pew, and it, like, slowly, like, it doesn't zoom in on him, but the picture turns black around him. So then there's just like a little highlight there, as if to be like, oh, there he is, like a Where's Waldo, like Where's Al Pacino, like situation. And I was like, that was so weird and out of place, and I didn't understand what was going on with it. But anyways,
I feel like a lot of movies in the 70s did that kind of shit.
Well, and that's why I'm like, oh, it's freaking, like, you know, I'm fine, for sure. But I was like, that's the only thing that felt just like, I was took me out of it a little bit, I guess is what I'm saying. Sure. I was just like, what?
It's yeah, like, there's things in this that, like, I'm so, like, fascinated about, and, like, about, so I guess when he made The Exorcist, I think it was The Exorcist, he had hired some guy in, like, whatever department, I forget what department it was, that turned out to end up getting arrested for murder.
Oh.
And, when... God, I wish I could find this. Fucking IMDb's down, of course, like, as soon as we start recording. I'll see if I can find the actual story on here. All right, here we go. Let's see. Wait, no. This is not it. Anyway, he had hired some guy that worked on, like, The Exorcist that got arrested for, like, some murder, then some aspect, that also may have hinted at being the killer that is based on these movies in real life. Like, when, I guess when he was getting, like, interviewed for, you know, by the police or whatever, after he got arrested and maybe booked, I don't know. But he kind of, like, hinted that, yeah, there's, like, some more, you know, bags of bodies out there or something. And, like, it was called, like, the body bag murders or some shit like that. Because, like, somebody was killing these gay men and just, like, cutting them into, like, a wild amount of pieces and just, like, dumping them in bags. And it's just, it's wild that, like, somehow Friedkin had, like, hired this guy on a movie prior, and it ended up being, like, the guy that most likely was responsible for the murders that this movie's based off. It's to some, like, hate crimes, but I don't know if it's that guy or not.
Yeah, I know that there were, there was some, like, weird backlash about the fact that it's somebody within the group because of the way that the men are being, like, found or, like, stories, right? So essentially, what's happening is that the killer is going back home with, like, these men, right? And he either, I don't really know that they make it super known. It's really similar to a lot of, like, the men who have either gone missing or been found. And so he's like, how's about, first of all, he asks a lot of really rude, like, he's basically, like, asking him if he's, like, interested in men at all, and he's like, ew, gross, I don't think so. And, like, the whole thing is, nobody's supposed to know that he's doing this, right? So he goes, he gets an apartment rented. And he also has this other life where he has a girlfriend who he's hiding what he's doing from her. And so, like, he also doesn't know anything about this because the ending is weird, right? It's a twist ending. It's a little open-ended. And I think there's, like, room to kind of, like, argue what the ending is. I think secretly Al Pacino's character was at least curious. Because there's scenes where, like, he obviously is trying to figure out, like, there's, like, a scene with, like, bandanas where, like, if you have a bandana in your pocket, it means different things.
Yeah, that's, like a real thing.
Right. And so he figures that out, and then he's, like, not really wanting to, obviously, like, dip his toes into any of it. So he, whatever. But there's a lot of scenes where, like, he'll be in the bar watching whatever crazy thing's happening, and then he'll go visit his girlfriend and immediately have sex with her. And this happens multiple times. And then it gets to the point where they get in an argument because he's not sleeping with her anymore. And she finds that strange and, like, what's going on? And he's just like, it's just my work. It's messing me up or whatever. And I'm like, messing you up because you you want the D, I think. Because then he, like, befriends this guy that lives in his apartment who he becomes, like, friends with and, like, really close with. And I think that, like, what they're get this is the way that I took from it. I think that he himself had some kind of, like, stigmatized views on, like, what it meant to be, like, a gay man, right? Mm. And so he was, like, adverse to it, and he was, like, doing his job out of whatever. They make him seem like the nice guy, like, oh yeah, I just want to do whatever I can to help, who cares? And he befriends this guy and goes to the scene, and I think he realizes that, like, hey, this isn't wrong and bad, like everyone's been saying, it's, like, totally fine, these are real people with real feelings and blah blah blah. Because then at the end, I think that they are trying to, once they get the guy who's actually the killer, Al Pacino's, like, best friend neighbor turns up murdered, and there's some speculation as to whether it was his character, and I personally thought it was.
Was him it, being, was it the, like, that best friend, or was it the guy that he gets in the fight with that he is murdered?
I think it was, well, that was his boyfriend, the guy's boyfriend.
I guess I wasn't clear on, like, which person he killed. I thought it was, like, the dude he, like, went over and was, like, giving him shit. He, like, bursts in and fights him a little bit.
I thought it was his friend. It might be, either way, it kind of, like, works for me, because either he's trying to protect that guy. If he killed them, though, I feel like, I thought it was his best friend, right? And in my mind, I was thinking, like, the case is over and he's not going to be part of that world anymore. And he, I think, was like, I just need to, like, sever my ties with it and, like, move on from this guy, and I have to kill him. I don't know.
Yeah. It's Pacino's performance in this is really kind of fascinating, because, like, I think he's good at it, and I know, like, Friedkin doesn't, or, I mean, I think he probably thinks he's, I don't know, he's got very weird view on Pacino in this movie, but, like, I guess a lot of the stuff shot in the actual clubs, like, the sort of freaked out look he has throughout is real, because he was like, I have no experience with this, and this is, like, my first time seeing anything happening in these clubs. And he was like talked about it. He was like, I was freaked out. And William Friedkin was just like, left a lot of those takes because he thought it made it seem like more realistic.
Real. Yeah.
Okay, hold on. We're going to get back to this. So the film is a very loose adaptation of Gerard Walker's novel, but a bigger inspiration for Friedkin was the discovery in the 70s of body parts discarded in New York City's East River, which coincided with a series of slayings targeting gay men. Some of the parts were found in body bags belonging to NYU's Medical Center Neuropsychological Division, which is where he filmed a scene for The Exorcist. An extra in that scene, a radiographer named Paul Bateson, was later charged with being the serial killer responsible for those body parts and was convicted of murder. Friedkin went and spoke to him while in custody, and Batson admitted committing the first murder but having no recollection of the rest.
He confessed to Friedkin?
Well, I mean, in as much as, like, he was already convicted, so I think he was just like, yeah, I did that, but then was like, I don't remember the rest of them. So this is a thing I was looking at where it was like somebody wrote an article, it was like 31 things we learned from Friedkin's commentary track when it got released on DVD or Blu-ray.
Okay.
As opposed to like an actual like detailed fucking recollection of what happened. And it's because like a lot of the stuff in it, like Friedkin had that where he was like, like in his mind about when he was making it, he had some like NYPD like detective friend that was like sort of the basis for Pacino's character that he would like talk to about a lot of shit, which is where I feel like a lot of the cop stuff of this comes from.
Sure.
I do, I guess in my view, not being a trans person, like I thought the handling of like the trans sex workers in this was like obviously traumatic, but like I was surprised there wasn't some sort of like joke about them. It being 1980, I thought they were treated relatively like okay for.
Right, like normal versus
Yeah,
terrible.
like they weren't jokes. They were, obviously being like traumatized by these cops, but like weren't like shit upon as trans people, which I
Yeah, are
found
you
pretty surprising.
Yeah. Are you talking about like the ones who got picked up by the cops
Yeah,
and the
and like it's
cops
like sort of
like
like an informant for
assaulted
the
them or
one
whatever?
cop.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Like I every time they showed up, I really expected there to be like some for like a fucking slurs thrown out at them or some shit, and I was like genuinely surprised that did not happen.
Yeah. That's fair, yeah.
Yeah. Good problematic movie.
Yeah, I mean, like for a 1980s movie, obviously it was obviously yes, problematic, but kind of not as bad as I expected. I didn't starting the movie though, I didn't look up anything on it, so I didn't actually even know what it was about. And I was really pleasantly surprised. I loved that the bar was called the Cockpit.
Yeah.
Amazing, loved that.
I forget if they use the real names of the bars in the movie. I know they're like actual functioning bars that I think might still exist,
Yeah.
but I can't remember if they changed the names in the movie or not.
I think that's all
Steven Spielberg was
the.
originally going to direct it, but chose Jaws instead.
Oh,
I
okay,
can't
well.
even imagine how shitty this movie would be with Spielberg in control of it. Yeah, I guess Richard
Weird.
Gere was originally signed to do it. I don't know. I'd be interested in like a late 70s Richard Gere thing like this.
I think he would have been fine. I don't know. Al Pacino was looking pretty good in the movie, I will say.
Yeah.
There's a lot of good outfits going on in this movie.
I do think it's very funny that like I guess like when they would be filming like outside, there was like a concentrated protest from
Yeah.
gay men where they would just hand out like whistles and like things to like
Disrupt it.
reflect light at like where they were shooting to like
Holy
disrupt the
shit.
shooting and cost the studio like a shit ton of money.
I mean, I get it, right? Like, it's you, it's like one thing to have a movie about like somebody targeting gay men and killing them. That's like an out-group kind of person, but when and even though it is a little bit more stigmatizing because it's like somebody that's like in the group or whatever. And so like I get that.
Yeah, I would say like if you've seen this movie and you're interested in like people that know what they're talking about it, or like from at least a like I think Queer Horror Cult has talked about this movie. I just don't know what episode. I was trying to find out, and I know Twitch of the Death Nerve has done like an episode on it, and like Sam Deegan knows like a lot about like the making and sort of like behind the scenes shit going on with this movie. So I would say definitely check those out.
Yeah, for sure. We don't. We're not historians in any way
Well, it's
of.
like again, this was my first time watch, so like
Same.
it
Yeah.
was very much a like I was just like kind of trying to take in what I could. And I know the Twitch of the Death Nerve crew has seen it multiple times, and I'm assuming Lori from Queer Horror Cult as well. All right, we'll jump to 1990s Nightbreed by
Hell yeah.
the King Clive Barker.
What a king.
So this was maybe only the second time I'd seen this, and maybe the first time I've saw the actual like director's cut. I think I saw it in like the 90s when it was like the cut the studio did that like.
The cabal cut.
Yeah, like whatever cut that like Clive Barker did not like.
Yeah. I think that it's either director's cut, and I think they call it the Cabal cut, which was like the quote unquote original movie. This is one of my top favorite movies. Like, I wouldn't say it's in my top five, but it's definitely in my top 20, let's say, sure. Which I know is like not saying a lot, but I think I talked about this when we did our very first, like, Welcome to Spiderberg, kind of, like, what got you into horror. And for me, this was, like, obviously, I, against my will, watched Pumpkinhead, and that was, like, my first kind of, like, into it. Nightbreed was, like, one of the first movies that I feel got me into horror, even though it's, like, it's kind of like, I don't know, watching it now, you can really see, even though you can watch the director's cut that's on Tubi right now, you can still tell there was like a lot of, again, studio interference with this movie. And I think you can really tell because I feel like if you haven't seen it a few times and know what's going on, the story can be a little confusing as to like what's happening. But the thing that, like, drew me to this movie in the very beginning and kind of, like, got me into horror in general is, like, it's half kind of, like, monster movie and half slasher. Because you have, like, behind the scenes this person who's, like, literally a serial killer going around killing people. And then you have this, like, other character, Boone, who is, like, having nightmares or whatever about like monsters, and the monster makeup in this movie is like really what got me into horror in general, I think, because I mean obviously I used to watch like, you know, Goosebumps, Are You Afraid of the Dark, and Goosebumps more so than Are You Afraid of the Dark does have some kind of like practical effects kind of stuff like that, but this was the first thing I feel like I watched that I was like literally like blown away makeup. And I don't know how young I was, like, probably when I watched this, I had no idea what was going on, but I just was, like, so mesmerized by, like, the detail. The monster makeup is great. There's, like, scenes where they just kind of, like, show going through Midian, like, they just put so much detail into a character that you see one time and it's like a second flash on the screen. You know what I mean? And it's just like literally visually so stunning. I just was like, this is it. This is it. This is my life now. Like this movie is like the perfect between like monster movies and then like true. There's like that true crime, like slasher part of it. There's a scene that like, I will say the movie's a little bit long. I feel some cop stuff that's a little unnecessary, but other than that, I don't have any complaints. There's a scene where there's a lady who's like working at a motel and she is eating what looks like the most delicious like croissant that's like stuffed with like cream or whatever, but it like falls on the floor and she's like picking it up off the floor and she sees like the doctor's like he like walks in or whatever and she's like thinking it's her like husband or whatever and she stands up and it's just like his head on the desk and I was like ah like I don't know, it's just really great. I love it. I don't know, that's my small two cents about this
good
movie.
I think like I toss between this and Hellraiser as like his best movies. Which, like, my ratings on Letterboxd don't show that, but, like, because, like, Hellraiser is, I think, like, I gave it, like, a 5-star. Maybe 4, sure. I forget, and I gave this, like, 3.5. But I think Hellraiser is a better-made movie. I think this is a way better concept and, like, makeup movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the creatures in this look amazing. It's essentially, like, horror X-Men, which I'm on board with. Sure. David Cronenberg as the killer is fucking killing it. Like, I keep seeing people complain, they're like, his acting is so wooden. And I'm like, yeah, but it works. It's like perfect for that role.
I didn't even realize that was him. I, like, to be honest, didn't realize that was him until this watch. And I was like, oh my god, what?
I think that was one of the things that, like, made me rent it when it was on, like, VHS.
Mm-hmm.
Was knowing that, like, Cronenberg was, like, one of the main actors in it. And I was like, I want to see what this is all about.
I think he does a great job. He has this, like, kind of, I don't mean this in a bad way. He's got kind of like an uncanny valley look about him.
Yeah, like
that's like off-putting, and he is like a brutal murderer, but he acts so even-toned that it's like creepy. It's
perfect that he's like, yeah, he's supposed to be like a therapist, psychologist, I forget, yeah, which. And he's just this like monotone delivering like doctor that is also just like a complete like lunatic, but like never breaks that like facade of his,
never,
like,
yeah,
just monotone speaking. It rocks. His mask
and
fucking,
I was gonna say, so especially creepy when he's got the mask on and he's talking to people. It's just like when I forgot her name somehow, the Lori, who is the main character's like girlfriend, goes to Midian to like find him, and she has that like woman that she met at the bar or whatever, and she's just like hanging out like waiting for Lori, and he just like walks up and like, I don't know, when Lori finds him, and he's just like, she's like, how do you know my name? And he's like, oh well, probably, I don't know, it's just, yeah, like I can't do his voice obviously, but it's great.
Yeah, he's very good.
I think the thing that I like so much about this movie too, it's that it's like, you obviously picked this for our thing because of Clive Barker, but it is one of those movies that like
it's not explicitly, it's not like Knife Plus Heart or like
right,
you know, being a very like very specific like gay queer like horror movie. This one is very much in like coded messaging throughout. It has Clive Barker's like experiences as a gay man like all over this movie.
Yeah, and I think that's like what I enjoy so much about it, is that like on the surface it's, I don't know, the plot itself is like a little, I don't want to say convoluted, but it is complex enough where it's like, if you want to just watch the movie as like a monster movie, just like a straight out like monster horror movie, you can, but it is coded to where if you can pick up like so many different things and like the meaning of what's happening, that's part of like what I like about it so much, because I was watching this movie for like years before that even occurred to me, and then I was like, wait a second.
Yeah, like I said, like it's very much like horror X-Men. It's like, and I was reading an article, I wish I could remember where it was at. I feel like it was in the AV Club or something, where the guy was talking about how like it's very much like a chosen family sort of, yeah, thing, where it's like Boone seems like he, other than like not wanting her to die, seems to have not much interest going on with Lori, and is way more invested in this, like, family of, like, monsters, and being with them instead. And especially, I think, in the, like, original cut. Because I think, like, I haven't seen the original cut since probably the mid-90s. And,
yeah, no,
like,
me neither.
I was trying to, like, see, like, read some stuff about, like, some differences in it, and it seems like the studio cut, which I feel like probably unbeknownst to them, because I feel like nobody in a movie studio in the 90s doing this stuff would have realized any subtext in this movie, like, cut a lot of the stuff that led to, like, a lot of the, like, homoerotic aspects of it.
Yeah.
Because they all, like, I guess when it was like came out and they were promoting it, they were like the studios just promoted it as a slasher movie. They focused,
right,
heavily on, like, Cronenberg's character and like killing people, which is not at all what this movie's about.
No, and I can see why at the time, if you went in thinking that and then you saw the movie, you'd be like, what? I for one would have been tickled, but I couldn't see how that wouldn't, like, come across, like, well at the time.
Yeah.
But.
It's, I've never read any of Clive Barker's books. And I think this is based off one.
Yeah, this is based off of Cabal. I have been, like, dying. I haven't read anything by him either. And I've been dying to, and it's, like, been on my list, but my list is just very long. So I want to read Cabal for sure. And then I think that Hellraiser is, like, Hellbound Heart or something like that. But I'm more interested in this one because I really want to see, like, what the actual...
I may have read Hellbound Heart in, like, high school and just don't remember.
Yeah.
Like, if I've read a book, one of his books, it was that for sure. I don't know. I feel like, I'd be curious to read this, because this is another one of those ones, like how it seems like almost every fucking Stephen King one is, where it's, like, based on, like, a novella that just gets, like, stretched out too long. But I feel like this one, like, works, as opposed to where, like, Stephen King's just end up being, like, relentlessly boring.
Where
it's just like, here's like a two-page story for an hour and 50 minutes. So I'd be kind of interested to, like, read what this is based off of. Because I really love the, like, concept of this movie.
Yeah, me too. And I feel like, obviously, like, say, you know, everybody knows my gripes with Stephen King, and I think that at a time, he can and has been a very good author. I feel like nothing that he's written, though, compares to the, like, complexity of the ideas that, like, stuff I've seen based on Clive Barker's work is.
Yeah, for sure.
Like, Stephen King didn't write Hellraiser, you know what I mean? And, like, maybe some people will come at me, but, like,
it is very, like, much like Stephen King is, like, the airport novel of, like, horror writers, right?
Right.
Like, his stuff isn't, like, there's not a lot of, like, deep thinking going on, I guess. Like, there's not a lot of subtext. It's very much just, like, very on the nose of, like, what that book needs to be, right? And I feel like, and it's also, like, Stephen King's just, like, a straight white dude. So, whereas opposed to, like, Clive Barker's writing from, like, experience as, like, I assume at some point a closeted gay man and then, like, an open gay man, and, like, especially in a genre, in a time period at his height where, like, that was not cool.
Yeah.
Like, and, like, I think it's one of those things where, like, I don't know how many people knew he was, like, openly gay in, like, the horror community. Because, like, it's one of those, like, you know, like, obviously the internet wasn't, like, a real functioning thing, like, when this came out. And, like, you know, Hellraiser, like, you know, sort of bondage-esque Cenobite stuff aside, isn't, like, explicitly gay. Like, I feel like this kind of feels...
Yeah, I mean, they do sort of do the same thing with the quote-unquote, like, the Midian monsters, or I don't know if they had another name besides, like, where a lot of them are, like, kind of like a stereotype of that, where a lot of them do have still, like, leather. There's that one, the guy that has, like, the dog, where he's got, like, the tattoos over his nipples or whatever, who is in, like, a really submissive, like, role or whatever. So I feel like there are still some things that you could pick out that are the same as Hellraiser, but this goes, like, even farther than that, I feel like.
Let me see if I can find it again. There was, like, something I was reading about the specifically, like, the outfits and, the, like, what the monsters wear in the movie that I thought was kind of funny. I can't remember where I found it. There's apparently a comic book based on this. I would like to read that. Yeah, I can't find this.
that was really like one of the things that I think about just like in general about the movie is also I feel like a lot of stuff we're talking about doesn't make any sense unless you've seen the movie, so sorry if you have no idea what we're talking about. But like, so there's like a ritual that you have to do to be able to like get into this like group, right? And Boone does it after he's been killed. And he, like, comes back to life or whatever because he is a part of, like, a prophecy for Midian. And so, like, basically, there are some really hot monsters. And there are some really unfortunate-looking monsters. And
is the guy with the moon-shaped head hot?
Not to me. but, like... there's like a scene where Laurie is like walking around through kind of like the underground of Midian, and they show a ton of the monsters, and like some of them are not cute in my opinion. And so basically the only thing that happens to Boone is that like he pretty much looks the same. He just gets like carvings on his face, so I'm like, okay, he's still like conventionally like an attractive monster guy, right? And I thought, then there's, like, this other guy that gets turned, and the only thing that happens to him is that the top of his head kind of, like, balloons out, and he looks crazy. And I was like, that's not great. And I thought it was, like, really brave of Laurie at the end to be like, don't leave me. I'm going to kill myself. Turn me into a monster or whatever. And I was like, girl, you don't know what kind of monster you're going to turn into. That was, like, really sus of you.
I'll take it. I would rather be one of these monsters or a vampire or whatever.
Although, I guess, technically... Laurie was talking to, I can't remember her name. She's like Babette. Babette is like my favorite. I've been obsessed with Babette since I was young. Babette's like the little girl who's like a little creature. She gets like she's playing outside, and then the sun comes up and she turns into that creature. Yeah, yeah. Then Laurie saves her, and she's like a little girl who can like has powers or whatever. Babette's the person who was like acting as her like guardian or whatever, is telling Laurie that essentially like this collection of people are all like the last of their lineages, or like the last of their species that have just been like scared away into hiding because, you know, quote unquote normal people don't want to, like, they just want to, they would rather just kill them instead of try to understand them, which again, there's like the, you know, the coding or whatever. Yeah. So I guess like technically if you are human, then maybe you stay looking human, just something happens. But like I said, that one, the guy, his head gets all balloony. And if that would be my monster form, like, I feel like I'd be sad. I want to be like the hot porcupine girl.
Yeah, or but if you just like, if you looked weird and fucked up, you could just go haunt Zach Baggins.
Okay, fair.
Oh my god, I know, like, you know about this, but when I was in the ER, like one of the only like one of the only channels we got that wasn't the news was, what is that, Discovery, that's on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so we had to watch the one where he goes to Joe Exotic Zoo, and then one, I think it was called like The Devil's Den.
Yeah,
like a juvenile to like prison or some shit.
Yeah,
and he's a fucking weirdo.
Amazing. That Joe Exotic one was so scandalous. I couldn't even.
I think we saw like the last half of it where they're just like, I don't know, we think there's some bodies out here still, and the police don't care. And I was like, well, yeah.
Yeah, because the police investigated it, and it's not true.
There was a moment in, like, the Devil's Den one where he gets, like, possessed. And, like...
but, those are the best.
Like, acts like he's attacking one of the cameramen, and I was like, this is insane. This is the fucking worst.
That is not the first time, and it won't be the last.
Oh, I know. Either. It was very funny. And then...
that's hilarious.
Expedition Unknown, I think. Anyway, back to Nightbreed.
Yeah.
Apparently, Rutger Hauer and Christopher Lambert were originally who they wanted for, like, Boone. I could see maybe Rutger Hauer, but this guy's fine. He was a fucking hacker in the best Turbulence movie.
Yeah, I think he's fine. I liked him.
He's, like, a very... he's, like, a good, bland, white dude.
For, yeah,
this period.
Exactly. I agree.
Hot Porcupine Girl, I'm also very positive, is the inspiration for an actual X-Men character that looks just like that from early 2000s, I think, maybe late 90s.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know if they're, like, in the comics, but I know they were in, like, X-Men Evolution, the cartoon, and maybe, like, made it to the comics. Let's see if I can find it. I think they were, they're, like, the, I forget what the name of the, like, the sewer characters in that, or, like, the underground characters, like, I think they call them the Morlocks, maybe. This is not coming up with that. Anyway, yeah, this movie rocks.
Yeah, very good.
You should go watch it, because I feel like it's not free a lot of the time.
No.
I have a lot of periods.
Shona Sassy. I'm gonna look her up. Is her name.
Oh, the character?
Yeah.
Well, because, yeah, there's, like, different ones. There's, like, a character named Quill at one point. And then I think the one I was thinking of is this character named Spike, but this is not... Or this is what, like, Google was telling me, but it's not who I was thinking of. I feel like that's probably... There's probably, like, 20 X-Men with this power of just having spikes all over their body.
Yeah.
X-Men Evolution, also very good. Go watch it.
Unrelated, yeah. Yes.
All right, let's talk about 2018's Knife Plus Heart, a very sad movie.
Yeah.
So I fucking love this movie. I've wanted to, like, this is one of the ones that, like, when we were doing the, you know, we each were picking movies that were good leading up to episode 200. This was one of the ones I wanted to do. And I think it had, like, just left streaming for a little bit around the time we were picking stuff. But I fucking love this movie. It is probably, like, the best version of a modern giallo I've ever seen. And, like, I don't know. I fucking love it. What'd you think?
I think it will... I don't think it's surprising. This movie is not for me. I was going to say it has very, very strong giallo vibes, which is what I picked up off of it. And so I can very, very much see how you would be super into this movie. But for the same reason, I was not. And it's not necessarily that it's a bad movie. It's just, like, again, I just don't know why I have such a hard time watching them. And I also... Okay, so I watched Cruising first, which was, like, 3 hours long, and then I tried to watch this immediately after.
All three of these movies are, like, an hour 40.
Yeah, it was hard to watch back-to-back.
Well, Tubi also doesn't help with this. Like, this should not be... Like, the first time I watched it, the first couple times I watched it, I think it was on, like, Shudder, maybe. And, like, the commercials, yeah, like, really hamper the flow of this movie, I think.
Yeah, definitely. Because, you know, also the commercials are in, like, the weirdest places ever. Yeah. And I was like, oh, what's happening? It's, like, almost like a slap to the face. And I think for some reason I just, like, had kind of a hard time following, like, what was happening in it.
I could see that. I feel like the first time I watched it, I don't think I fully, like, picked up a lot of what was going on. And it is also one of those things that, like, it's in...
French,
yeah. I don't know why I thought it was...
No, maybe it might not be.
It says France, Mexico, and Switzerland.
Yeah,
France,
it is subtitled. Yeah.
And so it is one of those things that, like, if you've only watched it once, it is very much like you spend most of that time reading.
Yes.
So, like, because it's like there are... I feel like this is a good... Like, one of those movies that is, like grows on rewatches for people. Because once you kind of know the plot and you, like... Because this is another one, like, Cruising, like, it's gorgeous to watch. Like, the cinematography, the way it's shot, like, it is, like one of my favorite-looking movies of the last decade.
Yeah, and that's the qualities that I like about it are qualities that I like about anything that's, like, that is, like, a giallo-type thing, where I thought the lighting was cool. I liked some of the shots, like... There was one, and I don't know anybody's name also, because yeah, I couldn't, like, it's, like, one thing to read it, but then when the actors are saying it, obviously, they're speaking a different language, so I couldn't, like, I just was, like, having a hard time grasping it, right? But there's a scene where, like, they all wrap a movie. I guess, like, we should say that this is about, if you haven't seen it, the main character is, like, a producer, or she the director, or whatever.
Yeah, it basically follows this, like, crew that makes, like, gay porn films in the, like, late 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, somebody, like, you know, like a mask, leather glove.
Of course, right, yeah.
Killer, like, killing people that were, like, in this crew throughout the movie.
Right. So, it basically, like, follows that, and then the main character, she's also, like, had gone through, like, a breakup recently, but she, like, still is seeing her ex, and, like, that part was, like, hard for me to watch, too, because I think my problem is that, like, I didn't like anybody, really, because it's, like, she was, like, trying to, like, force herself on her, like, ex, who was, like, I'm not interested, like, stop, and I was just, like, it's heavy, I guess is the problem, and some of the time, I just can't deal with it, like, I'm not, whatever.
Yeah, but yeah, like, this has, like, as opposed to just being a sort of, like, straightforward, like, slasher movie, like, right. This has a lot of, like, relationship stuff going on.
Right.
And it's, like, Anne, the main character, is, like, one of those characters that's, like, likable and unlikable at the same time. Because, like, I like her in the movie, but she does shitty things throughout the movie.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. And, like, I like her partner in it. Like, I feel like she's the, like, the one person you kind of are, like, actually, like, can root for. Like, I guess, like, a lot of the people that get killed, like, they don't do anything, like, but you really do focus a lot more with, like, Anne throughout the movie. Yeah. Anyway, like, I get what you're saying in, like, that aspect.
Oh, yeah. Oh, but there was a scene where, like, and I also just, like, anytime that they showed them making the movies, I just, like, didn't understand. There was, like, the one scene where she was, like, so she's, like, and that's part of the problem, like you were saying, with having to read the subtitles, is that she's constantly talking to them, like, okay, good, now look this way, look at whatever, so it's, like, hard to focus, right, if it's first watch. But, like, there was, like, this one scene where she was, like, leading the camera through this warehouse, but they had separated it by, like, I don't know, like, mesh curtains, and there was just, I was, like, I couldn't figure out, like, what was going on. There was, like, a mirror, somebody was, like, I don't know. It was also just, like, conceptual that I was, like, I don't know what's happening, which is fine. Like, I barely know what's happening in Jalo movies. Like, I'm not saying that me not liking this movie has anything to do with the movie itself. But there was a scene where, like, they wrap up one of the movies and they go to have, like, a cast party, like, in the park or whatever. And then this, like, storm comes really fast and everybody leaves, like, this one guy by himself. And he ends up getting killed, like, almost immediately. But I thought that scene was shot really cool. Because it's almost more like a play, if that makes sense. Like,
yeah, I can see that, yeah.
He gets stabbed from behind, and then it's, like, storming. But the rain is, like, really heavy, like, behind them, the way that it's shot. And it just was, like... So I guess, like, this movie to me did not look like it was made in, like, 2018 or whenever, like, it came out.
Very it's the thing I think that does really well is it looks like obviously, like, the production, because it's filmed on, like, way better stock or, like, just video, like, whatever. Like, it obviously looks cleaner than a movie in the 70s, but it looks like it was made in the 70s.
Yeah, it really does. I feel like it's probably one of the best, like, new, like, successful to me, newer, like, Giallo, it's not a Giallo, right, really.
I would call this a Giallo. Like, I would
okay.
say it is. Like, there's this, and there's a Spanish movie called Crystal Eyes that I think are, like, probably the two, at least that I can think of offhand, like, the two only real modern Giallo movies.
Yeah, and it's, like, it does it properly. Like, it looks, it feels, all of that stuff. Like, if you, I don't know, it's, so if you are, like, very much into that, this definitely would be a movie for you.
Yeah, and, like, I think it's very much made, like, as a, but, like, Death Drop Gorgeous has, like, a lot of Giallo influences in it, but isn't made to be, like, a Giallo, where, like, this,
right.
I think, very much was supposed to be like that, and it, like, I think it does it really well. Like, the,
and I think
the killer design is
yeah.
creepy and rocks. I
yeah.
love his dildo knife weapon. Because this is a fucking, like, if you're gonna do, like, what, like, this movie, like, I think you have to have that, like, extremely absurd weapon.
For
it to work, and, like, it rocks. Like, the scene when, like, it, like, pops through the back of the guy's throat.
Oh, my God. And I think, like, the kills did look cool. You know, it's just, it is what it
That's
is.
Fair. It, like, I kind of said earlier, I think the, like, dichotomy of between this and, like, Cruising is, like, you could tell this was made by somebody that's actually queer.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
it's very,
for sure.
very specifically, like, it is, like, it's a traumatizing movie.
Yeah.
But, like, not, I feel, it's not traumatizing in the same sort of way that I feel like Cruising would be for, like, a gay person to watch now.
Right.
Like, this was, like, this is, you know, just traumatizing in, like, story as opposed to, like, I don't want to say intent, like, Cruising. Like, I don't feel like Friedkin's, like, intent was to, like, be kind of problematic with it.
Well, and I think that's the problem. That is inherently the problem,
yeah.
because it's, like, if you can have, you know, the best intentions in the world, but if there's elements of it that you fundamentally, like, don't understand because you're not in that
right.
group, then that's just how it is, right? And you're gonna, you know.
Oh, like, and, like, the thing in this is, like, you, like I said, like, you, as opposed to just being, like, we're Cruising, you're essentially just following a straight dude in these clubs. And
well,
this
and
is, like, you're actively following, like, queer people.
Yeah, and I think you can tell, and I think, like, I think you can tell when you're watching it who made it.
Yeah.
Even if the intent is to showcase something, or, like, you know, like, hey, we care about all of these men that are being murdered. We're trying to, like, stop it. I'm going to make a movie about that because I think it's fucked up that there's hate crimes or whatever. But you can tell, I feel, by watching it, like, it just feels different when you're watching it. Yeah, I was just saying, I feel like you can tell there's, like, a level of authenticity. It is not the right word, but, like,
yeah, like,
I feel like
actual
you can tell
lived experience.
Yes, and, like, yeah, like, they know what they're talking about, or, you know, whatever.
Oh,
that
well,
there was, is missing from.
There was something I was gonna bring up earlier when we were kind of doing, like, talking before we jumped into, like, Cruising. Talking about, like, you can tell the differences in, like, some of these movies. It's like, so, like, two of the ones that happened recently that I think show, like, a movie made specifically to be, like, hey, like, this is, like, me as a gay person living in the world and made specifically to be for fellow gay people. And then, like, one that's, like, made by a studio to be marketed towards straight people, and that's, like, Fire Island and Bros.
Mm-mm.
Where Fire Island is essentially like Pride and Prejudice, but like modern and like just all gay men on Fire Island, right? And it like, it's not like I didn't necessarily like. Caitlin and I watched it like when it first came out because Caitlin loves like Bo and Yang and I can't think of the guy's name, the other guy he does a podcast with, but that like they're like kind of who was behind it, I believe. Mm-hmm. And so we watched it, and it's like, I don't care about Pride and Prejudice. And, like, I don't know if I found it as funny. Like, it's just not my sense of humor. Mm-hmm. If you listen to this podcast, you know my sense of humor is, like, you know, extra stupid. And so, like, it's totally, like, a good movie. It's put together well. But you watch that, and then you're like, okay, this is very specifically, like, this was not made with, like, straight people at all in mind. This was made right. to be like, hey, like, queer people deserve rom-coms too. And that's what this is. And, you know, it's very specifically for that. Whereas, like, I haven't seen Bros, the Billy Eichner, like, what was, like, the first major studio, like, queer rom-com or some shit was how it was, like, promoted. And, like, so many people were just like, this is just, like, what straight people think gay relationships are like. And, like, it, like, flopped hard at the box office, and Billy Eichner had, like, a fucking meltdown. Which Ooh. Sucks, because, like, I like Billy Eichner, although he is wildly annoying on Twitter. Like, I liked him a lot better before Trump was a thing, and he just made that his entire fucking, like, personality. Like, Billy yeah. on the Street, I think, is very funny, and he's, like, fucking great on, like, Parks and Rec. And,
yeah,
like, his,
yeah.
I love, like, him as the librarian on Bob's Burgers.
Yes.
But I feel like that's, like, a, like, you could look at Cruising and, like, Knife Plus Heart in the same way, where it's, like, I think Cruising had the best of intentions, but no matter what, it's a bunch of straight people making that movie.
Right.
And, like, I can't speak specifically on the cast in Knife Plus Heart, but I believe most, if not all, were, like, queer people. And so, and, like, it's just the fact, like, you can tell, like, especially now, like, in these movies where it's just, like, They/Them was, I think, maybe directed and written by a queer person, but like you can feel the straight studio interference in that movie, because
yeah.
everyone is the most stereotyped version of what like I assume Jason Blum thinks like a trans person and a gay person and a lesbian are like. They're all so like superficial.
Yeah. Just because you dressed up as Megan for jokes yeah. doesn't mean that you know anything. And,
like actually, is Jason Blum gay?
I have no idea. I don't know.
Feel like I don't know. It doesn't matter, but like I don't want to call him like a straight person if he's not, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, like you can oh no, he's married to a woman. All right.
I'm just kidding.
Like you can tell that like you could just tell, I think, when there's a lot of, like, straight people behind a quote-unquote, like, queer movie, especially in horror.
Yeah.
Because, I think I said, like, one of the aspects that, like, really works for me in Knife Plus Heart is, I guess, what doesn't work for you is, like, the relationship stuff. Because, like, it, especially with Anne and her, like, ex, it, like, Anne's obviously not, like, a good person in it with her ex, but it feels real as opposed to just like it feels more real as opposed to where I feel a lot of them either go like over the top, everything's great in our relationship, or like everything's like just like messy all the time. And I feel like they do a thing throughout where like you can tell, regardless of what's happening, that, like, her ex still cares for her in aspects. Like, she does. She fucking, like, jumps in front of a knife or bullet or fucking whatever in it to, like, yeah. save her. And, like, even after she's, like, fucking, like, assaulted by her. And yeah. it's, like, that's why I think she's, like, the only fucking, like, likable character in the movie. Is she, like, makes these boundaries and then, like, I don't know, like, still sacrificed her life for somebody that she, like, once cared deeply for. And I don't know, I kind of really like that aspect of it. Yeah, I don't know, I think this is a fucking banger. You don't have to. I kind of felt like it would go either way, because, like, I was curious as, like, a non-Italian giallo, how you would, like, view it.
Yeah.
And, like, it's whatever. Not everything's for everybody.
Yeah. And
this is extremely my shit. This is also another one that, like, I think Queer Horror Cult has done a very specifically, like, a long episode talking about this movie, and it's, like, it gets brought up probably, like, every other episode. If you want, like, Lori and Aria have, like, are very, like, insightful about this movie, especially, like, with Lori's, like, Italian horror giallo love. Oh, I'm and, sure. like,
yeah.
I think Lori's actually, like, taken a bunch of classes on, like, queer cinema. Like, I don't know. If that's another one you could check out that's not from, like, us. We're just dummies that talk about shark movies.
Yeah, I mean, like, pretty much. Yeah.
I do, like, I really love... I love that, like, in this, the killer is also, like, relatable is not the right word, but, like, sympathetic. Because when you finally get, like, the backstory of what happened to the killer and, like, what's going on, you feel bad for them as well. Like, you just kind of feel bad for everybody in this movie because it's just, like,
yeah.
sucks for them, like, all of the time.
Yeah, and I mean, like, it does come down to, like, I understand what you're saying, because, like, at the end of the day, there's no excuse for murder.
Yeah.
Or killing people, but sometimes you do have a circumstance where you're just like, oh my god, that really sucks, like, okay. I understand. It's not okay, but I understand.
Yeah. Yeah. I thoroughly enjoy all of these. Probably Knife Plus Heart Cruising, then Nightbreed for me. I assume it's Nightbreed Cruising this.
So, yeah, except that I did also watch All About Evil.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Why did you pick this one also?
Well, I did not watch it, but it was one... So, my well, because, like, originally we talked about we were just gonna do the three movies because, like, you've been having all the dental work, I'm getting ready to go on vacation and shit, and it was just like, well, we'll just do, like, the three, and, like, the three we ended up picking were, like, Heavy, and, my original plan is I was trying to pick something that's sort of, like, a group of movies that, like, touched on, like, different aspects of, like, LGBTQIA+ sort of things, mm-hmm. which is why, like, originally it was gonna be, like, I think it was, like, Cruising, Knife Plus Heart, Titane, and then All About Evil. And All About Evil was specifically because it's, like, you know, especially right now, made by, like, Peaches Christ, who is, like, a drag queen. And I'd never seen it, and I was like, well, like, you know, fuck it, why not? We'll pick this. And so, like, I don't know a lot about it, but, like, Severin released it, and I was gonna buy, like, blind buy it, and I was like, well, I'll wait. So, maybe you will, persuade me to buy it.
Okay. I will say, I had never heard of Peaches Christ, and I 100% stan. Love to death. Okay, so I, had never heard of this movie. It's from 2010. It stars Natasha Lyonne, who I love. Cassandra Peterson's also yeah. in it. Didn't know that. Pretty awesome. I have to say, extremely... I'm gonna not spoil anything because I think that you should just watch it. I personally loved it. It is basically about this girl who... inherits a old movie theater from her father, where her father was like very much into like playing old horror movies and like bringing that to the community. But it's kind of like in a community where there's like not a lot of people that care about it. And she's going to just try and like save the family business because her mom, who is like a super bitch, is like trying to sell it. And I don't want to give away anything that happens because there's a few things in this movie that I literally gasped when they happened because it is so amazing. Peaches Christ is in it as just a kind of like a person that comes to the movie theater. So they're not in it a ton. And like overall, not really. It's not like not anything that I saw was like very coded about it, but as a movie, just in general, I thought it was so funny. I don't really think I'm spoiling it by saying it's gore. Obviously, it's a horror movie. It's kind of like a horror comedy, though. So there's like gore in it that is very good. I love the concept of it. And the only thing that I'm gonna say is like there were some moments where like it's very much like I said, a comedy, and so sometimes some of the acting missed for me just in the way that some of the performances were. But overall I loved it.
I think if I remember correctly, because Severin, when they like do new like whatever, like their monthly like slate of movies drops, they do a podcast episode discussing like what's going to be on the Blu-rays and the movies and how they acquired them and stuff like that, which is extremely cool. Like, I like that they do this sort of like behind the scenes of what all goes on behind like these boutique like movie labels. And I feel like their description was essentially like if John Waters made like a legit horror movie. And I was like, I'm interested. Caught my attention.
Yeah.
Like, is it, like, campy? Or is it, like, more straightforward?
It is a little campy. Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't say, like, I saw somebody compare this to Death Drop Gorgeous, but I don't really agree with that.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of, I feel like what ends up happening is it's just like, what's another drag movie in horror? This. Yeah. So.
Yeah. I mean, it does have some though. And like I said, from what I took from it was like, I don't know. I feel like it is a little hard to go into it without spoiling it, but I really don't want to. I think people should just go in blind because I had no idea what it was about going in, and I ended up just like loving everything about it.
I think at some point I'm just gonna have to like log in on like my Chrome browser to fucking watch it, because just Shudder not being helpful with any of their apps working.
There's like I don't know. I think I say this kind of often, but there's not a lot of movies that I watch by myself where I will laugh out loud. Mm-hmm. And I did laugh out loud in a lot of these.
Just this and Hot Rod.
That's it. That's all. yeah. So A+ for Peaches Christ from me. Amazing. Love it.
Yeah. I'm definitely going to check it out at some point. It's like, it's been on my watch list since whenever Severin put it out, because I had never heard of it until they talked about it. Mm-mm. And it's like,
yeah.
I feel like anytime them or Vinegar Syndrome releases a movie that wasn't made in the 90s or back, I'm always like, okay, you've got my attention, because like usually y'all only focus on stuff made pre-2000, so anything like after that, I'm always like, all right, this is probably worth my attention.
Yeah, I feel like
based on anything I've seen or heard about it, it looks like it's like right up my alley.
Yeah.
I guess real quick, do you have any other like queer horror, or I guess maybe not even horror, like movies that you like?
I don't know. That's kind of like what I was like talking about in the beginning, where I don't feel like I've seen a lot of actual movies. I finished But I do read a lot of them, and I just finished this one, like, sapphic horror that's called Our Wives Under the Sea. I forget her name. I need to look it up. That I high recommend. It was so good.
There's, like, I don't know. Like, it's like when we were, like, trying to pick movies for this, it's like all of the lists on Letterboxd. I'm like, can you stop making lists on movies that, like, aren't specifically queer, but you just, like, have now written or, like, made canon that they're queer, like The Babadook?
Yeah, and I have an issue with that too, because, like, there are, like, I feel like we talk about this a lot when we talk about, like, AAIP and things like that, where, like, there's confusion as to, like, what counts as it. Like, it's not sometimes, like, for that specifically, if you're trying to, like, promote, like, a specific group, like, you're going based off of who made the work, not what it's about. So, like, it can't just be a story about, like Memoirs of a Geisha is a good one, right? That's just written by, like, I'm pretty sure a white guy. That doesn't count, right? And a lot of people don't make that distinction. So, like, just because the story, I don't know. Does that make sense?
I know what you're saying.
Okay. Okay, so it was called Our Wives Under the Sea, and it's by Julia Armfield, and it is, like, a sapphic, like, kind of aquatic horror story, and it was literally so good. I'm on, like, a reading challenge right now. I've read maybe 30 books this year, coming up on 30 books this year, and it's definitely, like, one of the best books I've read so far this year, so that would be, like, a high recommend for me. I'm reading one right now that is kind of weird, though, because I think you would consider it more sci-fi. It's by whoever does Welcome to Night Vale, that podcast. Mm. It's called Alice Isn't Dead, and it's basically just, like, about this woman who is, like, on a quest. She's, like, on a quest, like, trying to find her wife or whatever, and that one's been kind of interesting. I'm trying to think what else.
I'm trying to look at, like, lists for horror movies, and it's just making me mad.
I know, it's hard.
It's just, like, I just stop, like, I get it. The Lost Boys is homoerotic.
Right, and, yeah, sure.
Or it's, like, it's just, like, movies where there's, like, one gay best friend in it or some shit, and I'm like...
Like Tammy and
yeah,
the T-Rex.
Yeah, like, come on.
Yeah.
Although... Dude rocks.
100%. I feel like anytime we watch a movie that's, like, not, but there's, like, the one character, we're like, this is literally the best person in the whole movie, though.
Alright, well, since you were not on the last episode we did, do you want to talk about some stuff you watched recently?
Oh my god, I've watched so much, actually. And I'm glad, because I was like, if I have to keep it for another week, I think I will forget everything I watched. I don't remember if I talked about this on the last episode that we did. Did I talk about Unfriended?
I don't think so.
Okay. Maybe I stopped with Fear, and because then you were like, yeah, idiot, everyone's heard of Fear. And I was like, what? I've never heard of it. I did finally watch Unfriended, which I thought was very silly, and I hated it.
It's very ironic that, like, I feel like the one found footage movie that I was like, this kind of rocks, is the one that, like, everyone else hates.
Well, because we were talking about that, and in regards to a movie we no longer talk about because of whatever, that's, like, why that came up. And I do agree. So Unfriended is essentially, like, another, like, internet, it's like a Skype call.
Yeah, the entire thing takes place on somebody's, like, laptop screen.
Right, and I will admit that I think that, because, like, the other movie that we're comparing it to is literally just FaceTime on your phone, so it is different, because this movie is from, like, what, 2000?
Well, yeah, it's mid-2000s, I think.
2014. So, we've got Skype, we've got
Spotify,
like, whatever. There's a bunch, it's, like, multimedia, YouTube, so I think that they do a better job with all of that stuff. I just didn't find anything about it scary.
No,
there was, like,
yeah,
not enough ghost stuff for me. I didn't understand. I don't know. Whatever. It's fine.
I think the I think the way it's pulled off is better than the movie actually is. If that makes sense, like I think the premise, I guess, is a better idea than the actual.
Then what? Yeah. Okay. Done. Yeah.
Like, cause
sure.
Like, I like that. Like, there's just like long periods of silence, and you just hear like, keyboard clicking or like, you know, notifications or like. There's points where like, the only score is like she'll put something on the background on like Spotify on the computer or whatever. Right. And like, I don't know. I like that version better than like Host.
Right.
I stand by the only good thing in Host was the mask.
I still, regardless of it all, love Host.
But like, yeah, I've been meaning. I actually want to get around to watch Dark Web, like the sequel to it, and I just never got around to it.
Yeah.
Because I've heard it's like, it's better because it's like creepier.
And I think like that's what I'm missing from Unfriended is that it's very much a like Ghost in the Shell type situation versus like something outside of it, like whatever. Same like kind of premise though with like, yeah, I don't know, whatever. I didn't like it overall. Then I watched Prisoners.
I don't know what that is.
Which it's a Hugh Jackman, Jake Gyllenhaal movie where Hugh Jackman's like daughter gets kidnapped and Paul Dano.
I think it's Dano.
Dano. He is suspected of being like the one who, I don't know. I loved it. I thought it was so good. I think that it's kind of like it is a movie people like, right? It's the director who did like Dune and Blade Runner, new Blade Runner or whatever. So it's like liked. I just had never seen it.
Denis Villeneuve or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. It was so good. It's really good. I loved it. Then I watched 47 Meters Down Uncaged by accident because I was trying to watch 47 Meters Down. And then I never got around to watching that, only Uncaged. It was fine.
I think you'll like the first one more.
Yeah. You and I were kind of like texting when I was watching it, so I don't really feel like I need to say that much more about it.
I think it rocks. I think it's amazing that a major studio made that movie because it feels like a Sci-Fi Channel movie.
Yeah, it really does. The idea, I will say, some of it did get me because this essentially takes place in like underwater ruins, and the girls are underwater like almost the entire movie, and so there was like spaces where it felt very claustrophobic, and I really hated it. But then the ending just really was wackadoodle and not in a good way. I think
is it like does it end like where like doesn't like a fake out or whatever a couple times or something?
Yeah, so like the ending is that they're on like a vacation, like a school vacation or something, or just on a vacation with people from school. And at the very end, they end up escaping the underwater like ruins or whatever, and they see a boat, and it ends up being like their friends on a shark tour. So they're swimming up to the boat, and a guy is chumming the water, and they're swimming into the chum.
Genius.
And there's like this scene where both of the girls are like trying to get up on the boat, and every time they try, they like reach the boat, a shark comes and grabs them, and like it's just like it happens like 5 times, and I was like, okay, we're done. And then I think they both survive. I'm not sure, but whatever. Really, really wackadoodle movie. And then I watched, I watched Lights Out.
I saw that in the theater thinking I was going to see Don't Breathe, and then the trailer for Don't Breathe played before, and I was like, wait, what?
Right, and I'm really confused because there was a movie that Kit watched recently, but I think it's Darkness Falls, and I get Lights Out, Darkness Falls, and The Darkness all mixed up, and The Darkness was that Kevin Bacon movie I watched a little while ago that was really, really terrible, and I think I thought I was watching Darkness Falls, but I watched Lights Out, and I know it's an uncommon opinion, but I actually really liked it. I thought...
Yeah, I think Lights Out is totally fun.
I think that they did the stuff with, like, the creepy Marie, or whatever her name was, the creepy entity, I thought was very cool. Like, it really worked for me. I liked it. Then I watched Uma.
Oh, the, Sandra Oh movie?
Yeah.
How was that?
I liked the concept of it, but it wasn't, they just, like, didn't execute it very well, in my opinion. It was, like, okay.
I don't actually know what it's about. You don't have to tell me, because it's whatever, but, like, I just, like, I feel like it came out and a bunch of people were like, fuck yeah, and then, like, immediately stopped talking about it.
So, like, the premise is essentially Sandra Oh is, has, like, there's, like, a lot, she's Korean, and so there's, like, some, like, familial trauma that the movie deals with, and I just feel like they just did that thing where the ending was just such a, like, a cliche ending. Mm. And it just, like, wasn't executed in the way that I feel like I would have liked it. So, I don't know. I feel like the idea behind it was interesting, but I feel like it's a pass for me. Like, I don't think I would recommend it.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like a lot of people really enjoyed it.
No. And then I finally watched It Follows.
What'd you think of that?
I fucking loved it. I thought it was so good. I loved the score.
Yeah, the score, like, I obviously genuinely rocks.
I obviously already knew what it was about because it's, like, very talked about, but I loved it, and I was like, God, I do that. It's just, like, one of those movies that at the time was so popular that I was like, yeah, whatever, I'm not going to watch it. And then I finally did. I really loved it.
I guess I can't say I hate it. I think it's fine at best, where, like, like, everyone else, like, lost their goddamn minds, and I was like, I don't know, I've seen better versions of this, like... And, like, I, you know, I'm not, like, putting down anyone that likes it. Like whatever you want. Sure. It's just, for me, I was just, like, I don't understand the hype around this when, like, I feel like I could watch a better version of this movie. I do think there's genuinely some creepy shit in it, and, like, the score rocks. And I would also like a clamshell reader.
Yeah, I mean, yes.
Although, it makes goddamn sense how it would function and be, like, at all fun. It just looks cool.
Yeah, I need a clamshell reader to read my fanfic about people I know. But like, what?
I've also it felt very anti-sex to me the first time I watched it.
Well, sure.
So, like,
yeah.
And I don't know if that was just me or if that's, like, an actual intention or not. Like, I don't want to, like, say that was the intention. But, like, I was just, like, I kind of got put off by that a little bit.
No, I could see that angle of it.
But it's definitely, it's a well put together, like, movie, regardless.
Yeah. Okay. Then I finally watched The Witch.
It's another one I did not like.
So I tried to watch this a couple years ago, and, I ended up liking it. I do have some issues with it. Like, I don't think I liked it simply because I fucking love, like, 1600s Puritan movie type things and witches and whatever, obviously. And I just got done reading this book called The Hour of the Witch that I loved. And so I was like, you know what? I'm in like a 1600s mood. Let's do it. So I finally just watched it and I really liked it. I will say, like, I don't feel like the ending made a lot of sense to me, but, like, overall, I liked it.
I think it looks great. I just did not give a fuck about the story at all.
Well, and, you know, I love Anya Taylor-Joy, so I was, like, into it. But, like, overall, I really liked it. I think I gave it a four stars, even though, like, I don't think I would say it's one of the best movies I've ever seen, the way, like, some people freak out about it. Because there's just, like, something about the plot line felt disconnected to me in a way that I just need to ponder on a little bit more, I think.
Yeah, fair.
Then, to... Oh, and then I got another root canal, so I watched The Craft, which is one of my all-time favorite movies, so of course.
Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Do you think The Craft holds up, or is it just nostalgia? Because, like, there's a lot, like... very specifically, because I watched it not for the first time, but for the first time in, like, since it came out, probably. Like, I think maybe right before I moved to New Jersey, and I was like, woof.
I think it holds up, but I think it's, the graphics, no, obviously, don't look great. Like, that scene where, they're, like, doing glamours or whatever.
Yeah.
And, Sarah, like, does her, changes her hair color or whatever, looks really bad. I think it's, I think it does hold up, but I think it's for a specific group of people. I don't think it's, like, a mainstream, it's for everybody, it holds up.
Not a 40-year-old white dude.
Right. But I don't know. It's like one of my all-time favorite movies. So I like kind of comfort watched that as I was, you know, delirious. Then I watched a movie that was from 93 that had Kathy Bates and Edward Furlong in it that was called A Home of Our Own. And it was kind of just like a slice of life, like poor family trying to get their shit together kind of situation. And it was fine. It was very depressing, obviously. And then I watched Summer of Fear, aka Stranger in Our House.
Is that the, it's a Wes Craven movie, right?
Yeah. Bad. Not good.
A hot take. I don't think Wes Craven is as good a director as everybody gives him credit for.
I feel... No. This had... Also, this had Linda Blair, which was, like, pretty much the reason that I watched it. This movie is a... another witch movie, which is, like, probably my favorite genre of movie. And it's from the 70s. They had some great... I don't know. I like the concept of it. I just don't feel like it was done well.
Yeah.
Like,
I agree with that.
I don't know. It was not good, I would say. Then I rewatched Spider-Man Homecoming. Amazing, perfect, spectacular movie. Then I rewatched Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness, which I actually liked a lot more than the first time I saw it. This is only my second time watching it, and I gave it 4 stars this time instead of 3.5. So
yeah, I like that movie despite its flaws.
Well, yeah, I think it's good. Then I finally watched Nope.
Oh yeah, I still haven't watched that.
It was okay. Again, very, very cool concept. There was just, like, some stuff in the movie that I felt was very unnecessary, like, didn't have anything to do with the plot of the movie at all, that I was like, are you just trying to stretch the runtime, or, like, what? Obviously, I love Kiki Palmer. She's, like, one of the main characters. Steven Yeun was in it also. So, like, overall, very cool concept. Visually very cool. I just felt like it didn't blow me away the way I was hoping it would.
Fair.
I'm almost done.
That's fine.
Then I watched Smile. Boo! Terrible. So bad. Stupid. Somehow has a 3 on it. It was essentially even dumber version. If you didn't like It Follows, you're not gonna like Smile, because it's like the same idea.
It's
where
pandemic,
something
It Follows.
It's like, well, so, oh my god, it's basically just like this creature that follows you and it feeds off of trauma, and so it makes people like it spreads by like you witnessing somebody die by suicide, and then it spreads to you to where you get crazy, and then you have to, it's just like fucking stupid. Then they like reveal the thing, and it's like a thing. It's literally the same thing where it's like, sometimes the thing will show up as somebody you know, or sometimes it'll be a random person, but you know it's them because they'll smile at you. And I'm like, oh, okay. It was stupid. Dumb. And then I just watched the stuff for the podcast, so that's it. Woo!
I teased a couple things, but, like, in the last episode I did with Kid, but, like, pretty much everything I'm watching right now is for Junesploitation, and for me and Chris are gonna do an episode on that at the end of the month, so you can hear me fucking scream about the Ridiculous Six for...
Oh my god. I told you not to watch it.
I picked it specifically. I knew I was gonna hate it, but I was like, I picked, like, a good Western and then the worst one I could find, so...
Fair.
And Ridiculous 6 was the good one. 5-star now. Fucking movies.
So quite bad.
Possibly one of the worst things I've ever seen.
Yeah.
Yep. Alright. Yeah, shout out.
Oh my god. I just shout out that book I think people should read, Our Wives Under the Sea. Go read that.
There you go. Jonathan Snipes, because I can't remember if I shouted this out yet or not, has a new score for a short movie called Adventure Never Ends, a tabletop saga that's about, like, tabletop gaming. And the score is fucking gorgeous. You can get it on Bandcamp. It's very good. And then I think the Friday before this comes out, Gary, our guest on the Crow City of Angels episode, his Memorage album comes out. So, go check that out. It's self-titled. It's very good. Very excited for it to come out and, like, more people to hear it. I think that's it. I feel like there's one other thing, but I can't remember what it was.
Did you shout out Brandon's, like, book? Is that still for pre-order?
That goes up for pre-order the 23rd.
Okay. I couldn't remember the date. I also have no idea. I feel like I go to the dentist every day, so I don't know what day any day is.
yeah, I don't, like... Oh, fuck, I had it, like, saved. Yeah. Brandon from, like, the Death Drop Gorgeous, St. Drogo, Monster Makeup Crew, from our Phantom of the Mall episode, has a book coming out called...
Eric's Revenge.
Called The White Bishop. That I think he said it goes on pre-sale the 23rd of June.
Yeah, you're right. It's right here.
BPShorror.com. You can find it. I'm very excited for that.
I am too, because also they're doing like a audio version, which I feel like is not super common. So I'm excited about that.
Yeah, I'm like, I want to grab a physical copy. But if anything, I'm definitely grabbing the audiobook because I will listen to that at work in like a heartbeat.
Yeah.
All right. Next week, it's going to be me and Katie again, and I think we're going to do Humanoids from the Deep remake, and Katie's going to watch the original for the first time. Never seen the remake. I've heard it's fucking terrible, so not really looking forward to
it. Looks terrible.
I'll probably rewatch the original too because the original rocks. Yeah, I think when we did the original episode is when I found out there was a remake and it like melted my brain. So I'm interested to see what that's gonna be like. if you would like to support us, you can join our Patreon at patreon.com/IHSufferPodcast. At some point in the near future, we'll have a bonus episode on M, Run and Kill, and a Double Team. Talk about some Dennis Rodman, JCVD team up.
This is the first time hearing of it.
It shouldn't be. I texted the group chat about it. It's just like a couple weeks ago because then I got...
What is it?
We did the votes on like Nathan picks, Katie pick, or Kit.
Oh,
whatever.
Yeah, boo.
Yeah, and it was mine.
I forgot about that. Wait, what are they? What are the
movies? M from, I think, 1931. It's on Max now. Also, like, on YouTube. Run and Kill, which is on the I Hope You Suffer YouTube, and then Double Team.
Okay.
It's a
All right.
Weird combo movies. So that'll be like, I don't know, whenever I get back from vacation, we'll figure out a fucking time to record that. You can buy merch at our storefront tier. You can leave us a rating on Spotify and a rating and review on iTunes. You can follow us on Instagram at IPCF for Podcast. Follow Kit at Hidden Kitstery and Kitrification of Blood. Only follow him for the hooch pictures. That's all it's in. It's the you can follow Katie at Werewolfface, and you can join Katie's Patreon at patreon.com/werewolfface. You can listen to my other podcast, the 8K Movie Club. Go support LGBTQIA plus people, especially now, because shit's bleak. I hate it.
It's not real great.
Bad time to be alive.
Yeah.
I always put the donate to Trans Lifeline at the top of our notes, like with a link. So if you're inclined, go do that.
Give it a clickety clack.
But I don't know. Just be there for people. Right now, because it's gonna be a fucking rough election cycle, I think.
Yeah.
But I don't know. We're recording this on the day Trump got arrested, so maybe somebody will hang him.
Idiot.
He's gonna wiggle his way out of it. It's not gonna matter. But seeing those pictures of all those documents in a fucking bathroom next to a toilet is very funny.
Some it's light reading.
Absolute fucking insane. Just insane fucking timeline right now.
Yeah, well, really, honestly.
We were talking about it in my group DM, but I was just like, I don't know. I've seen Trump's diet. He's probably sitting in that bathroom for a long time. He needs something to eat, so.
Yeah.
Fuck him. Fuck the GOP.
Yeah, support hate him. Losers.
Go watch some good queer horror. This, I don't know, all the time.
Yeah.
Because it's honestly probably most of the only good stuff happening in horror, at least for me at the moment. Say Drogo finally had their first public screening, and it sounds like it went well. So,
yeah, seems like so. Maybe not
first, they had the fest one. I guess they've had three screenings now. One that was cast and crew, like the two at Salem Horror Fest, and they just had one at like their like a public library or something like that.
Oh, I love that. Yeah, I saw they shared a bunch of like blurbs, and I was like, good for you.
I also like. They shared a thing about how, like, the New York Public Library has, like, Death Drop Gorgeous DVD in their fucking, Pride Month display. And I was like, that fucking rocks.
That's awesome.
All right, Humanoids from the Deep remake next week. I hope you, like, want meat, but why? I can't remember. I already forgot the quote. But everybody, I don't know. Be cool.
Yeah. Don't be lame, okay? Yeah,
be excellent to each other, like Bill and Ted said. Live your life like
that's
that.
That's right.